This week, we were going to talk to a Lib Dem, but then they did so badly in the Barnsley by-election, we thought, leave it a few weeks, maybe there's no need. So instead, we've got the leader of the party that came second in that by-election, the UK Independence Party, who says he wants UKIP to replace the Liberal Democrats as the third major force in British politics. The difference being, if UKIP got into government, I'd be praying they broke their promises. Please welcome Nigel Farage.
Thank you. No
fucking panto noises. Right. Now, Nigel, you did really well in the European elections, the last set of European elections, so why do you want to stop having European elections?
Well, you're right in a sense, and ironically, we do remarkably well in them, but we're beginning to do well in national elections too, and coming second in Barnsley wasn't half bad, was it?
No, absolutely not. But you do a lot better in European elections.
Well, because we have a proportional representation system.
Or because European elections matter to people less, and they have a bit of a punt on a party that they don't see as in the mainstream.
They go out and vote for a party that they think represents their view. We love Europe, we want to trade with them, cooperate with them, but not be governed by people like Herman Van Rompuy and their corrupt institutions. And that's not just the view of people in Britain, in France, in Germany, right across Europe, that's how people feel.
Yes, but you're saying that you don't want any sort of European Union. No one would argue that the EU was perfect, or maybe some people would, but I'm not arguing the EU is
perfect.
Nobody
does, no.
But you think we should pull out of it entirely and start again?
I think we should have a trade relationship with them, cooperate with them, agree environmental standards, do all the sensible things that next-door neighbours do, but not be governed by their institutions, and not have 75% of our laws now made by people in Brussels. And, you know, every week we hear David Cameron saying he's sick to the bottom of his stomach, that we can't do this and we can't do that.
But isn't that...
Whether it's votes for prisoners or whether it's car insurance premiums for young women, it's pathetic. We should govern our own country.
But people say, I mean, some people say that the European Union gives us a big... that makes money for us. We get trading advantages, and I think the government's estimate is it's something like 20 billion a year that we're richer as a result of it. Now, you would say that we're poorer as a result of it.
We pay a membership fee to these people of £48 million a day, and it goes to pay Neil Kinnock's pension and things like that. I mean, perhaps everybody's happy doing that. I'm not.
I don't want to see Neil Kinnock die poor.
Well, he certainly won't. Yeah.
He's not getting all the 48 million a day.
And nor will Peter Mandelson.
46 million tops.
And Chris Patten and all the rest of it.
But the point is, let's imagine a virtual world. But no one can decide whether the EU works for us economically or doesn't. There are people arguing on both. Well, you've decided. Other people have decided the opposite. But my question to you is, if it was essentially, it didn't make us money, didn't lose us money, would you still want to pull out?
Well, of course, because the most important thing is democracy. You know, the idea that we can vote for people that make our laws and once every 4 or 5 years judge them and get rid of them if they've done a bad job, that is absolutely fundamental, and that's what we've lost.
But would you want pan-European democracy? Would you be open to a European Union that was properly democratic, where the Commission didn't have more power than you think that
the opportunity to do that came with the European Constitution a few years ago, and they decided, no, we don't want that. The European Union, it isn't just undemocratic, it's now anti-democratic, because when the French and Dutch voted no, they just ignored them, changed the name of the Constitution to the Lisbon Treaty, and imposed it upon us. So right across Europe, what we're seeing is a younger generation saying, look, we don't want these dull, boring old men, these bureaucrats, running our lives.
Well,
we want proper democracy.
To be honest, dull, boring old men run our lives whether we're in Europe or not.
You may have a point.
So what politics is. Well, my point here, though, is I think there's an emotional thing about the European Union that never gets discussed. I think some people emotionally don't want to be part of a European Union. They want to be just Britain on our own. And some people emotionally like the idea of a federation of other countries and like the idea that perhaps we punch above our weight on the world stage if we're part of the European Union.
No.
Would you accept that there's an emotional
element? No, I wouldn't. I mean, what we're saying in UKIP is this. Look, Europe is not our future. If we're going to survive and do well in the 21st century, we've got to be part of a global economy. We should be embracing the Commonwealth, not turning our backs on it. And what we're doing is we're actually focusing in on Europe and forgetting about the rest of the world.
Surely Europe are much more sensible trading partners for us now than the Commonwealth, aren't they?
I think Australia and Canada and New Zealand and India and many other parts of the Commonwealth are the growing, thriving, booming parts of the world. That's where our real future is.
But Europe booms and they're right next to us. I mean, it's obvious that we'll always be trading with countries right next to us.
Well, of course we'll buy and sell widgets gadgets to each other. Of course we'll do business. Yeah. But look, you know...
We don't need any...
Europe,
even if you want a global economy, you don't see the European Union as a step towards a global economy. It's a step in the wrong direction.
No, it's the opposite. The EU is inhibiting us from doing global business. Look, Norway and Switzerland are not part of the EU. Their firms can do the same levels of business in France and Germany as we can. All we want is a simple free trade deal. Let's be friends. Let's be neighbours. Let's not be governed by these people.
But, and you don't accept that there's an emotional element. There's a little Englander element that we want
well,
our
if you
own
think,
sovereignty.
If you think being
Because I wouldn't
proud,
say that was necessarily a negative
being
thing.
Proud of being British, being proud of having a parliament, being proud of having our links and relationships across the world is a bad thing. I don't. I think it's a very good and a very positive thing. And it's not in any way anti-European at all.
No, but I think in the argument, people, you always cite the economic argument, the people on the other side always cite the economic argument, and nobody will admit to whether or not
the
they
like the democratic
argument.
The key is the democratic argument. And whatever you look at now in this country, okay. There is a European dimension to it. We're not governing ourselves. Westminster is full of impotent people, unlike perhaps Italy and their parliament. But, you know, we really are. We've reached this level where who we vote for at general elections has become meaningless. You know, the Lib Dems, Labour, the Conservatives, they look the same, they sound the same, and they can't make any real difference to our lives.
OK, I've got one last question. Are you a fan of Midsummer Murders?
Well, you know... I think they've made rather a mistake, haven't they? Because actually, isn't the truth that in Great Missenden that the local shop is in fact run by an Indian? And the whole point about the makeup of our society is we have always welcomed people from all across the world, but what's been a mistake since Blair came to power is to let an extra 3.2 million people in to what is already the most overcrowded country.
Well done for getting Blair into a Midsummer Murders question. I'm afraid that's all the time we've got. Thank you very much,
Thank
Nigel
you.
Farage.
Thank you, David. Now, in May last year, Nick Clegg was everybody's darling. Now he's about as popular as a black guy in Midsummer. It's hard not to feel sorry for Clegg, who's been making fresh attempts to reconnect with voters by identifying who it is he's fighting for. A few weeks ago, he talked about the people he wants to stand up for in an exciting BBC News interview.
Totally understand the kind of frustration and, if not outright anger, of many people who work hard, you know, pay their taxes, play by the rules, people in what I call alarm clock Britain.
Yeah, there's a sector of society Clegg likes to call alarm clock Britain. Literally, British people with alarm clocks. That's what he got into politics for. Since boyhood, he's yearned to represent ordinary, decent, clock-owning folk. And yet people scoffed at him. They accused him of empty soundbiting. It was a terrible loss of face. Luckily, being Nick Clegg, he still had one more face. A face he was prepared to show at this weekend's Lib Dem conference, at which, as the news made clear, the Lib Dems have gone from being the nice guys of politics to needing the sort of protection usually erected on the van windows of convicted paedophiles. The main conference draw was Clegg's speech, during which he promised that the Lib Dems would maintain their identity, saying, "We will never lose our soul." Well, according to the result in Barnsley, you did lose our soul. At least during his speech, he didn't mention Alarm Clock Britain once. No, he mentioned it five times, as you can see.
We're on the side of the people I call Alarm Clock Britain. Alarm Clock Britain. Alarm Clock Britain. Alarm Clock Britain. We are on the side of Alarm Clock Britain.
I don't know what he means. By repeating this, Nick Clegg identified himself as part of what I like to call Banal Cock Britain. Still, determined to hammer the concept of Alarm Clock Britain home, he's launched this, the Nick Clegg Alarm Clock Britain Alarm Clock. Just like Nick Clegg, it's guaranteed to put an end to all your dreams. It's got a brand shiny face masking an unfeeling mechanical interior. It's got a foot end here, and of course a bell end here. Although, I have to say, it's not a very good clock, because no matter what you want it to do, as soon as it gets to number 10, it doesn't give a fuck.
Find out more about who we are and what we stand for, go to the UK Independence Party website at www.ukip.org.